How is everyone? I have a little bit of an allergy, very rare situation that just popped up right after dinner. But I always say that every day we should shake the foundations of our spiritual understanding so that it's even clearer. And so this is what we're doing. The last several days, the videos have been so strong that they've struck me, and I'm having some troubles with of course, the wow nature of it all. But you know, after a while, it cools down, and you get a little used to it. The path can be quite difficult in this way, actually. I had a trouble sleeping last night, very tired. Saying what I'm saying is exhausting because the overall hostile environment into which this is being expressed is so strong. You know, you're kind of shaking from the potential backlash from the whole world, really. I mean, the universe. What we're talking here is non-dual. Non-dual. You can say non-dual Christianity, non-dual this, non-dual that. It's non-dual. And I say the root of non-dual is realization that there is no deal with God. In fact, God cannot make any deal at all. It's impossible. It's impossible to have a deal at all in reality. There are no deals. There are no deals. Our problem is we keep trying to put the spiritual truth into the formula of a deal. And this, you call this duality. Now, traditionally, duality has been this idea that there's God, the one, the formless essence of God. Okay, that's so far so good. And then they say, well, and then some evil force, some blocking, obscuring force appeared and blocked a spirit from God and is, you know, preventing us from relating to God, and we have to get rid of that force or have to defeat it. We have to, you know, this kind of thing, struggle against it. This is called duality. Those are dualistic teachings. The truth is that there isn't anything, a force came into the picture from somewhere. It is nothing more than our arrogance that we want to be greater than God. Okay. That's, and then believing that we made a deal with God, that we drop our interpretation of reality, if God drops God's interpretation of reality, and we'll suspend reality, as it were, until we determine which one is right, and we'll have this contest, which is actually what we call existence, time, space, process, and form, is this so-called autonomous force that we're imagining that is going to determine, you know, the outcome between God and spirit. All of this is not some external obscuring force at all. It is just our sheer arrogance on our part, on the part of spirit, which believes it can change God, and that we can be, spirit can be greater than God. So there isn't any evil force that somehow came in between us and God. It's our own arrogance. Okay, and this is what dualistic teachings, they don't get this. They don't get it. And this is what we have to get. Very important. There isn't any deal with God. There isn't any separation between God and us. There's no force in between God and us. There's nothing that we have to defeat or battle against, so to speak. We only need to repent from our own arrogance, which says that arrogance is causative, you know, that we can arrogate to God what God is, and that can have effects on God. And we just need to realize that arrogance is non-causative, that's all. So reality just is. It's not something to make a bargain with. So when we, our problem is when we experience reality, get a glimpse of it, we say, okay, well, how do we, you know, how do we get along with that? How do we bargain with that? No, that is what we are. That is our reality. There's no bargain. There's no deal. We keep thinking, well, how do we keep our deal with this? You know, how do we, as if we have some deal-like relationship or bargain-like relationship. It's not so much we have a relationship with God. We are God, so to speak. There's only God. It's the being. It's the isness. It's not like we are needing to know how to relate to God in a like a bargaining sort of situation or a deal like situation, like we need to do this in order to please God and that kind of stuff. That's duality. And most religions, most teachings in the world, at least in some of their basic forms, are very dualistic. And actually, new religions are being formed all the time in this world, and most of them are very dualistic. And so we have no choice but to drop our arrogance. This is the real path, is the path of repentance. And we must repent means to change our mind, drop our arrogance, really it means. Drop our arrogance. Stop thinking that we can change God. In thinking that we can change God, we think that we can force God into a deal with us, that God has to put reality up for up as has to post reality as if it were, like, how would you say this, like has to bet reality or in a wager, has to wager reality, saying, okay, if I lose the wager, it's collateral, has to put reality up as collateral in a bet, so to speak. Okay, we believe that God has put reality up as collateral in a bet with us, with spirit. This is not so. This is not so. So we don't have to win reality. We don't have to defeat God. We don't have to claim that there's an autonomous, something autonomous to reality, something outside of reality called time, space, process, and form. We don't have to prove anything. There's no deal at all with God. There's no bet. There's no deal. There's no contest. None of that is taking place. God continues to be exactly what God has always been. Reality continues to be exactly as it's always been. Right here, right now, everything is one with perfect reality. Everything is perfect right now. Nothing has changed whatsoever. But we're intensely projecting our desire and believing that somehow a contest is going on by the kinds of appearances that we are desiring to appear. It seems as though, but it's just a desire on our part to have these appearances. It doesn't prove that there's anything autonomous taking place. But it lends itself to that belief, right? The bodies and worlds and determinism of nature and the cosmos. It lends itself easily to us believing, like, oh, you see, there is this contest going on. But it's just a dream. It's just a dream that we're having. We're entirely responsible for it. So we have this dualism, which most... It's amazing looking at most teachings, and they're you realize they're entirely dualistic, but they often do all sorts of elaborations to try to hide that. And so the teaching seems very confusing and very complex, etc., because they're trying to figure out, you know, how to make this deal work, and it's dualistic. But non-dual is not complicated or complex at all. There isn't any deal. So how can there be a complex deal if there isn't any deal? How can there be an arrangement, a complex arrangement, if there isn't any arrangement? How can there be a complex contest if there isn't any contest? No deal, no bargain, no contest. It all is taking place. It's not taking place. It's not like we have to stop the contest. It's never started. It never started. So there isn't any some sort of complexity, really. In non-dual, there's no complexity at all, actually. But then we think, well, wait a minute. What, you know, but how do we make a deal? How do we make a deal with reality? We can't. Well, then, how do we believe that our arrogance is causative? We can't really. It's not causative. In other words, how do we keep the belief that it's causative if we don't have anything to base the belief on? And of course we can't. So that's why we keep being dualistic and saying that we believe that God is engaged in a contest with us, and we keep seeing appearance as something different than what it really is, as mere appearance. Everything that we're seeing, perceiving, is mere appearance, is mere appearance. It doesn't have any autonomous nature to it at all. There's no such thing as autonomous nature, actually. It's just the play of mere appearance that we're desiring in such a way that it makes it easier for us to project the notion that it's autonomous upon it, but it's not. So non-dual is entirely simple. We don't have to make a bargain with God. We don't have to make a deal. We don't have to go and have a business and be business, you know, partnership. We don't have to have a business partnership. We don't have to have a contest. We simply abide in as the oneness that is God. So it's not explainable. Reality is not explainable in terms of a contest, but virtually everybody is seeking that this sort of explanation. How do we explain? In other words, we need reality explained in such a way so we can understand how to make a better deal or how to make a perfect deal. Right? How to make a right deal, how to make a perfect deal with it. There isn't any deal. We can't make any deal. Even a perfect deal we can't make. It's already perfect. Perfection doesn't need to make a deal with itself. Doesn't make need to make a perfect deal with itself. And so just hearing this, it takes us, you know, liberates us from dualistic self-deception. And we stop demanding all these answers, because these answers are really, you know, based on belief that in making a deal or ultimately, you know, winning. How do we win the contest? You know, we're obsessed with, how do we win this contest with God? Do you have insight into that? Because is God helping us? Do you understand the nature of God? So how can we contest it? How can we deal with it? How can we bargain with it? There's nothing to bargain with. There's nothing to contest. There's nothing to make a deal with. There's no deals. So if you see this, then it's easy to understand. It's easy to understand. It's easy to... Your mind is not caught up in all these questions and trying to answer all these questions. But because we believe we force God into making this contest with us, and suspending our interpretation of both of our interpretations of reality, we say, okay, let's say neither one of us, we're not sure who's right, either reality is perfect or not, we don't know, so we're going to both suspend our interpretation of reality and have a contest to find out who's right. Well, God is reality. Reality can't suspend itself. Reality is not a perception of itself. Reality is not an interpretation of itself. Perfection is not an interpretation of itself. It's not possible to suspend. Reality can't suspend itself. But we believe that it has. And so we believe that there's an abyss. There's this, an abyss. And the only thing that's keeping us from this abyss is this contest we're having, which is time, space, process, and form. And that somehow keeping our attention on this, we don't fall into the abyss. So we're quite worried about, you know, if we think we see there's no contest, we think we're going to fall into an abyss. And so we keep saying, well, you know, you got to answer me, tell me, you know, what is reality like? What is it like? You know, what is it like? Liken it to something, explain it to something. What is it like? Well, it means that there's something else that we can claim and then claim to make a deal. We're interested in this deal of a contest, so to speak, and we feel we have to keep this deal of a contest going. And this colors our understanding. It colors our questioning. This fear colors everything that we're thinking, and we don't realize that our thinking is controlled by this very deep fear we have of a continuity issue. Also, it's a continuity issue, but also. I believe that somehow all bets are off on reality that no one knows. We think that even God doesn't know. We don't know. It's yet to be determined what reality really is. And so we think that this autonomous time-space process and form of dreaming, somehow that is going to be the new creation. And that will prove that reality, that maybe we'll say, well, neither God nor us was right, but here is the new creation. This is reality. Something autonomous to reality is reality. We were in church yesterday, and the priest said something. And it caught my attention. I said, whoa. And he's talking about the first communion. There were several young people having first communion. He said, When we eat the Eucharist, take the Eucharist, eat the body and blood of Christ, we are recreated as a new creation. We are now a new creation. And I said, huh? And this is the idea that somehow there needs to be a new creation. He said, well, we're humans, we're this. Well, wait a minute. So God created humans, and then now there's a new creation. That see, so this is very dualistic. Very dualistic. There isn't any need for a new creation. There isn't any deal with God. There isn't any falling away or separation taking place. There's nothing new. There's nothing new going to be created at all in terms of creation. Everything is still perfect. Everything is still perfect. And then he let slip something. It was very interesting. We get up to, we say the Lord's Prayer. We say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, we're out in heaven. Okay, so he says, okay, we now join together and we give the prayer that Jesus gave to us. And then he says, and so he's there behind the altar. We're getting ready to say the prayer, and he's going to lead it. And he says, okay, and he says, Hail Mary. And he goes, whoops, whoops. And everyone goes laughing, goes, whoa, you know. Never done that before. And this was a Freudian slip. Very much a slip of the tongue. And it's pointing out that what's being taught is dualism. Dualism. And this is very similar to the idea of the mother goddess redeemer enters into that. Also, it enters into Shaktism in India. The goddess as a redeemer of materiality is very dualistic. Very dualistic. There's dualism. That's not what Jesus came to teach us at all. So, it was showing that the dualistic goddess worshiping has really taken over the church. And this is something, actually, very interestingly, the Pope, with whom I've already excommunicated, actually, he basically said, you know, that men are the bad guys, and women are innocent, they're the good ones, and that we need to recognize this. Okay, these were basic, to distill what he had to say. He was amazing. He said, oh, women are, they've mistreated them, we've twisted the stories of this and that, and they're not, they're the good ones. And it's men who have done so much bad, etc. And we need to let women, you know, basically be the ones who set us straight. They're our hope and salvation. This is what we're going into, as I've said, in the world. And just after the Pope said this, then the priest is there saying, Our Father out in heaven. He says, Hail Mary instead. It's like, wow. Hello. This is what's reverberating throughout the church. So this is profound dualism. Profound dualism. Nothing has ever happened. Only our arrogance has happened. There's no estrangement from God. There's no separation from God. There's no contest. There's no deal. Okay? There's no defilement. There's really no time, space, process, or form. We're just imagining this is what's going on. Everything is perfect right now. Everything is perfect. It always has been. We're just insisting that it isn't. And this is our arrogance. Sheer arrogance. We don't need to be redeemed from or saved from this or that, except to repent. Repentance is the only way. We have to drop our arrogance. We have to be willing to see what is it really that we've done. Not some evil force coming in and separating us, no. But our desire to say that we can change God, that we're greater than God. And then, since we can't do that, to put it up to a contest and say whether we can do it or not is something to be determined. But there isn't any contest taking place. A contest with one side is not a contest at all. God has never engaged in this contest at all. Now, we arrogant believing that we force God to engage. This is not true. This is not true. So, as I've said, the Roman Catholic Church is actually now going headlong into humanism. It's trying to keep the trappings, but ideologically, it's going into humanism, and it's been very dualistic for a long, long time. But that doesn't represent the non-dual teachings of Jesus. It does not represent it at all. But again, that's just an example. The whole world basically is dualistic. Almost all teachings are very dualistic, and simply not true. They simply refuse to recognize. Spirit refuses to recognize its arrogance, thinking that it's going to be annihilated. It thinks if it loses this contest, it's going to be annihilated. The loser, the winner, is God. The loser is nothing, basically. Okay, in our contest that we've imagined, the one that loses, it loses all power, all will, all power. Okay, so we think we have to win. We have to win somehow. So this massive fear that we have of losing and of abyss and annihilation and all this, this colors our beliefs to an extreme extent. Colors our questions, colors our thinking, colors the answers we come up with. And we're pretty much unaware of this, that this influence, how we twist what is said. Even if you give right teachings, we end up twisting it. The fear twists it, distorts it. And so it's amazing, the interpretations we give, like Ramana Maharshi, reading the various interpretations that are being given about him by all different sorts of people, and it's just like, wow. You know, everyone has their own, says, no, he's like this, no, he's like that, no, he's like this, this is why, this is this. And Ramana says, I'm just simple being, that's all. Just simple being. That's it. But we cannot tolerate such an answer. Because we say, well, but what about the contest? What about the deal? I mean, you know, how do we win? You know, how do we get God back to being God? God never stopped being God. Simple being never stopped being simple being. It's just simple being. No need to conceptualize it at all. Conceptualization it implies a contest, actually. There's this and that. There's no this and that. We think, well, how can we be reconciled to being? There's no reconciliation. We never stopped being. God never stopped being. There's nothing to reconcile. It's not there's something that's non-being that needs to be reconciled with being. There isn't anything like that. It's merely our continuity fear of acceptance that needs to happen, that we gradually were able to accept this fact that there isn't any two sides to being. There's not something that's reconciled to being at all. We never left reality. We just tried to change it, but we didn't. But we're assuming that we must have somehow changed it, and whatever has been changed, needs to be reconciled with what wasn't changed. Like there's some sort of reconciliation that has to take place. There's nothing, no reconciliation that needs to take place. Everything is absolutely perfectly disposed in pure spaciousness right this instant, as it always has been. All appearance is mere appearance in pure spaciousness, and nothing else. Nothing has ever gotten out of alignment with God. It's impossible. How do you get out of alignment with zero dimensionality of pure spaciousness? You cannot. Appearance cannot get out of alignment with God. So we think we have to realign somehow. Something has to be realigned, reconciled, all these kinds of things. And it's not true. That's dualism. That never works. And it gets very complicated and complex, where they try to keep on putting in layers and levels to explain why it doesn't work. I say, well, you haven't done this yet. And then you do that and say, well, you haven't done this yet. And then, well, you have to do this. And then there's that. And you have to develop this. And it goes on and on and on. These are just rationalizations. Just rationalizations of why you haven't been able to reconcile or win the contest or call off the deal, call off the contest. We're thinking, oh my gosh, yeah, okay, it's wrong. Well, let's call off the contest. There isn't any contest to call off. We keep ascribing, arrogating to God qualities that God doesn't have. This is our trouble. And then believing that as our basic premise, and then trying to come up with a way to resolve it. And this then develops all these complexities of spiritual practice and endeavor and philosophy and nitpicking and all this stuff. We keep ascribing to God qualities God doesn't have. God cannot enter into any deal at all, any contest at all. Cannot. So it never has. So nothing has ever happened. No change has ever happened in reality. Nothing has been disturbed in reality at all. Reality remains undisturbed right this instant, as it always has been. So there's nothing we need to do to settle it down, actually. Now our minds are frantically desiring all sorts of appearances that seem to be efforts to settle reality down, but reality doesn't need to be settled down. It's undisturbed entirely. Pure spaciousness is undisturbed. It's always undisturbed. Now, is pure spaciousness all there is? Well, there's certainly appearances and experiencing in pure spaciousness that we call, this is our experiencing of spirit. But certainly, pure spaciousness is the ground of being, a ground of we call it God. And it doesn't change. It doesn't change at all. So realization of that, the unchangeableness of reality, the ground of reality, then we no longer misinterpret our appearances. We're no longer deluded by appearances. Whereas right now we're under a spell, as it were, like we can't. And we don't want to try to explain it too much, actually. But then it gets conceptual. It's overly conceptual, which you want to avoid. So reality is perfect. We just go back to that. Nothing has changed at all. So what we see is that there's nothing autonomous at all. And so there's nothing autonomous. There is no contest at all. There can't be. And then we misinterpret that as thinking, we lost the contest. God won. God swallowed up the autonomy or something. No, there never was any autonomy at all. So we didn't lose. There was no contest. We didn't lose. And so maybe this will help us from reacting like we have a glimpse of reality in that, and we misinterpret it, saying, oh my gosh, I just lost. You know, I just lost. There's autonomy has disappeared. Time, space, process, and form has disappeared. And we wrongly think that means we lost. And we think, oh, I'm going to be annihilated. Then we think, wait, how can I save myself? Oh, we start seeing it as autonomous again. Appearance is autonomous again. Time, space, process, form reappears. And we say, oh my gosh, I was just temporarily, somehow I lost my strength, but now I got it back. Oh good, I'm not going to be annihilated. You know, this is the delusion, the fear that we have. So if we see it properly, it's not the end of any contest. It's that there was never any contest. So yes, I already know that it's not the end of a contest. It's that there was never any contest in the first place, that there's never been any contest. Yes, I already know that there's never been any contest. Yes, I already know that it's not the end of a contest. It's that there never was any contest. Yes, I already know it's not the end of autonomy. It's that there was never any autonomy in the first place. There's never been any autonomy. Yes, I already know that it's not the end of autonomy. It's that there never was any autonomy. So when we're able to look at it this way, I believe this is the key to abiding in the non-dual, as opposed to getting a glimpse of reality and then reacting to that with fear. Many of us have had glimpses, but very few are abiding in non-dual, in reality, awareness of reality, the peace of reality. Very few are abiding in that. So we're trying to find out why. This is our inquiry, really. I mean, basically, these videos are for those who have had glimpses. Basically, I mean, it's for everyone, but those who've had glimpses, I believe, are much more likely to pay attention, because we're trying to find out, why have we only had glimpses? Why can't we stay in that, you know, that wonderful life? You know, it's life, actually. And so we're in pursuit of the answers to this question, to this very important issue. And hopefully this is getting to it. Shows very strong promise. And really, for those who have glimpsed it, this is all we want to know. That's it. We don't want to know anything else. I'm not interested in anything else about the world and all this nonsense. Because once you're abiding in truth, what else do you want? What else do you need? That's it. It's the retreating from it that's the problem. And we misinterpret this as thinking, you know, the contest is still on. That just reinforces our notion that there is a contest. There's a struggle going on. There isn't any contest or real struggle at all. Never began. There was never any autonomy. What is autonomous from pure spaciousness? And what kind of motion creates autonomy is a question, right? Is the motion of the universe, everything in the universe, that creating autonomy from pure spaciousness? What is it in the universe, in its motion, that is somehow affecting pure spaciousness in some way, or affecting its relationship in some way with pure spaciousness? What is it? And we're asking the problem we do is we ask the universe of that. Say, what is there? What, you know, who's doing what? Instead of asking pure spaciousness, why not ask pure spaciousness? Pure spaciousness, you know, is what is it that is affecting its relationship with you through its motion or non-motion, through its samsara or through its nirvana, through its motion or non-motion, through its action or non-action? What is it that is affecting its relationship with you? Pure spaciousness. We can ask pure spaciousness for this, and hopefully we'll get an answer. It's worth a try, isn't it? So again, everything, every situation that could possibly be, what is it that is affecting its relationship with you, pure spaciousness, if anything? And we certainly wouldn't be surprised at all if pure spaciousness said there's nothing that's affecting the size, the density, the speed, the motion, the darkness, the light, the quality of this, that, none of that affects. It's all mere appearance in pure spaciousness, and it's not affecting pure spaciousness. The relationship is not being changed at all by anything that takes place, any appearances, whatever the appearances seems to be dancing, whatever the dance is. Or even if the dance goes quiet and is motionless, that still doesn't affect it. Now, this seems simple enough question, right? And it is. It's just we're realizing we don't really need to ask any other question. That's the only difference, really, on the path. What the path is getting to the point where you just ask this one question like this, and you realize you don't need to ask anything else. You just answer just this one question. You know, this is it. And so then our attention, it gets more and more directed to that. Instead of all this other complexities, we say, no, just let us just ask pure spaciousness directly. Is anything at all just changing its relationship with you? Either motion or no motion, you know, either appearance or no appearance, either action or no action, either this quality or qualities or attributes or no qualities or attributes or whatever. Samsara is the world of all these activities and, you know, like the nature, like for instance, impermanence and all that. Nirvana is seen to be, you know, the unmoving. Everything is still and unmoving. But either way, is any of that, either samsara or nirvana, affecting pure spaciousness? And let's ask pure spaciousness. Let's believe that pure spaciousness can respond to us, actually. Why not? It's worth a try. Now, we don't know how pure spaciousness will respond. It may not be in words or concepts, right? That's okay. But let us ask pure spaciousness for a response to this question that we have, because this is what we need to have confirmed to us. Our suspicions is that it doesn't affect it in any way. I mean, our reason tells us it can't. It cannot at all. But why let it just sit with reason? Why not let pure spaciousness give its response, like an affirmation of some sort, like indeed, that's right, it can't. There's nothing. Let it, you know, express that it is not being affected in any way. You know, let that somehow, I don't know how it will respond, but we might as well try. It's cold out here, that's why I'm moving around with this shawl. It's So the more we can get our attention on asking this question, the better off. The closer we're getting to an answer. It's the only answer we really need. And it's more like a confirmation, and how this confirmation appears and how long it stays and what it's like. Well, we don't know right at this point, but we can find out. Try to keep an open mind. I try not to form a concept of how pure spaciousness could respond to this question. Just leave it open-minded, open-ended, without any conceptual framework or structure that it needs to fit into. Sort of full stop in the wow. Now, getting to this question, one has to have already evaporated a lot of the continuity fear around the imaginary abyss, brought to light how all this, why we believe there's an abyss, you know, our arrogance, the contest. We think that the winner takes all, the loser, you know, loses all, and believing that reality has been suspended by God and by us, and all this belief that we have in order to have try to be greater than God. We see this all now. We realize, this is just imaginary nonsense. None of this is true. That God did not enter into any deal with us whatsoever. Did not suspend reality in any way whatsoever. This is very reasonable to see. So we're able to recognize this. Our reason recognizes this. And then we're not so afraid to say, well, okay, can you confirm for us, God? You know, can give us confirmation that we don't have to do anything. Everything is still perfect, meaning nothing is affecting pure spaciousness. Pure spaciousness is exactly the same as it's always been. It's untouched. And with that reassurance, then we'll see where that takes us. We're told that this is what, you know, this is what's required. I think Ramana Maharshi said, nobody is saved except by divine grace. And divine grace is bestowed upon those who strive hard and continuously towards the liberation of freedom, towards freedom. You must make this very strenuous and continuous striving towards realization, and then divine grace will liberate you. Well, as I'm starting to see here that divine grace is ultimately the liberation. Could very well be this response from pure spaciousness, this, and how it responds to us, because we asked the right question. We said, hey, I believe that, you know, nothing's ever happened. There's never been any contest, and I'm looking about, and I'm seeing indeed everything is in pure spaciousness. And how could anything affect pure spaciousness? So, you know, nothing has changed. And so, and yet somehow Ramana said that you know, divine grace is really necessary to give us this reassurance in some way. So I believe that this is, you know, accurate. And so we can ask pure spaciousness to, you know, and see if it responds. And if it doesn't, because it's probably because we're still afraid of the abyss, we're still believing in a contest, we're still, as we said, as we looked at before, we get a glimpse of truth and then we retreat from it, saying, oh my gosh, I just lost. There's no autonomy anymore. There's nothing autonomous happening. But we realize now that nothing autonomous has ever happened. How could there be anything autonomous to pure spaciousness? And we just assumed that somehow this was suspended, that God suspended itself, reality suspended itself, and so we could have a contest. This is not true. In our playfulness, we think that we could play this way with God. They said God has to suspend reality so we can play the game of what is real and what isn't. But God cannot do that. God cannot do that. So we get assurance from God that indeed God said, I cannot do that. You cannot play that way. I'm getting sort of a reaction here. Boy, that allergy was really something. Sneezing, and came on inside the house very rapidly, but it's in abeyance right now. It's trying to come back. So the work we're doing is led to this question. And being able to formulate the question clearly and say, hey, you know, this is where attention needs to be. It doesn't need to be on any other question. Why not ask God directly for confirmation? If it's there, you know, let it be confirmed. Let it be confirmed. And if some people like the term God, and for some reason other people like the term, don't like to use that term because it has too much anthropomorphic connotations, which is okay. So you can use the term pure spaciousness or pure being or pure awareness or pure consciousness or anything like that if you like. I tend to like pure spaciousness because we see all these appearances and we can see, recognize. We don't see with our senses, but our we can't help but realize that, you know, where is everything? Well, it's occupies what? It's spaciousness, you would say. Everything occupies a so everything is dwelling in spaciousness. Without the spaciousness, how could there be any appearance at all, really? So, call it what you want. We can. It's the same. It's the same being. It's just one being, seamless, one seamless being. Where's the seams in this spaciousness? There aren't any seams. There's no inside or outside, in terms of zero dimensionality. There's no inside or outside, of appearance. Appearances are just through and through, completely permeated, and part of a continuum. Abiding in pure spaciousness, like salt dissolved in water. The water is salty, you know, but where does the saltiness start and stop? You know, where does the pure spaciousness, where do appearances have an inside and outside to them in terms of the relationship to pure spaciousness? You see, in relation to other appearances, there appears to be inside and outside. But not in relationship to pure spaciousness. There's no inside or outside at all there. And we can ask again, does the relationship of appearances, does that affect the appearances relationship with pure spaciousness? And then ask that of God, right? Ask that of pure spaciousness. Now, to get it past reason, past words, we need to go beyond this fear. My nose is starting to run. But whatever allergy it is, we need to get past this fear of maybe this is a liberation of the fear. fear of running. You know, my nose has been so runny. Maybe I'm letting go of that runniness. It's you know, it's expressing itself, and I'm just, and it, but yet it's maybe it's leaving me, or something like that, or it just came up in some way. The fear of I just lost autonomy. The idea is, in our deal with God, is that we believe there's something autonomous to, something separate, autonomous from reality. Very intense. And that it's becoming autonomous, and it's going to work itself into a perfect autonomy. And this will prove that we're right, that reality isn't perfect, and that we're now the new reality of this. You know, autonomous reality is the new reality. So, when there's no evidence of autonomous in relationship to God, where you see that everything is in relationship with God perfectly, then there's no autonomy. This is called the vision of oneness, a vision of perfect inclusivity. And then you say, wow, we can misinterpret that and say, that we lost the contest. It's gone, you know. It's been defeated. Okay, that's a misinterpretation. Rather, we recognize there never was a contest. There never was any autonomy in the first place. This is what we're getting at. This is non-dual teaching. The other is dualistic, saying there was autonomy, but it's been defeated. That will cause one to then be afraid of the abyss, and they'll resurrect the autonomy, their belief, in time, space, process, and form. They'll resurrect it to keep on struggling and battling and contesting and hoping to win. That we believe that protects us from the abyss, from annihilation, because that's the terms of the deal we think we've made with God, the terms of the contest, winner take all. Loser, go home. Loser. And there isn't any such deal again. So we don't need to be afraid that somehow we lost the deal. There isn't any deal. There's never been any autonomy. And if we see it this way, then we can just relax and abide in it. And that's the goal. As Ramana said, just abide in the self. The one all-pervasive self. The one all-pervasive pure spaciousness. Just abide in it, in this beingness, this perfect relationness, this perfect non-autonomy, this perfect non-separation. There's none of that at all present. And so we're just sharpening our clarity about this here, getting familiar with it. And that will certainly help us. Oh, boy. Very unusual reaction. Something's going on. There's no question about it. Dreams are not good. Have been bad recently. Very bad. Very tough. Very difficult. Odd. But you just have to keep keeping on when that happens. It is difficult to interpret, you know, what's going on, but I do know that this clarity is increasing to exponentially, so that is very propitious, and if we can be much calmer about our reaction to this and say, oh, okay, I just reacted as if I'd lost a contest, and realizing there's never been a contest, if we just keep reinforcing this, I believe our fear will calm down. It will calm down, and significantly calm down, and calm down, and calm down, to the point where we'll finally just say, yeah, it's no trouble. I'll just abide in this now. We can call this abiding in the vision of oneness if we want. Ramana called it abiding in the self. But I've never been particularly attracted to the word self. That has a lot of connotations. And different connotations, etc. But abiding in the pure spacious and in the all-inclusiveness and the all-pervasiveness and the seamless oneness of pure spaciousness, abiding in that. Now, I don't get allergies, so this is very strange. I just don't get them. This is very odd. It's a psychosomatic reaction in some way, it seems to me. As Ramana said, there is just simple being. That's it. That's it. That's all there is. Experiencing is not separate from this at all. An appearance is not separate from it. So there's just simple being. And our question is, well, how can we keep retreating from it? And we have this cat and mouse game going on. Well, we're getting to the bottom of that right now. So, this is enough for now. It's quite cold and I'm having this bad reaction. So, we'll get ready to wrap it up. It's not a bad, it's a severe reaction. That's fine. For a reaction this way, it's okay. Maybe it's the final play of reactivity. It's leaving as the answer from pure spaciousness is arriving, about ready to arrive. Our question we have: is there any? Has the relation anything affecting the relationship? Anything at all? And getting ready for the response, whatever it may be. It may not just be a simple word like no. It may be something else. Some sort of permanent assurance or some sort of very, I don't know. I'm very keen and interested in to experience what it will be. Okay, so we're really exponentially here getting to where we want to get to, which is this question now that we've seen, and abiding in the answer without retreating from it or reacting to it out of fear that we've lost any contest. Okay, wow, that's very great. We reached, looks like we've reached an hour, which is great. That's enough. Okay, very great. That's it.